Hey, Jess, I want to raise my mum from the dead.
Yeah, you can't do that. You might raise a demon, and it's, like, really dangerous, so you probably shouldn't. Like, you could die. It's a very, very dangerous process. I wouldn't recommend it.
Hey, Magnus, can you raise my mum from the dead?
No, that's very dark magic. It's actually very dangerous. I would recommend dealing with your grief and trying to, like, work things out. It'll be hard, but it'll get easier, I promise.
That's not what I'm looking for.
I'm gonna raise my mom from the dead. What's up, Shadowhunters, Angels, and Downworlders alike, and welcome to Fair and Unbiased, where I go into the nitty-gritty details of each episode of Shadowhunters every week. Here's my episode on Dust and Shadows. I am trying to be fair, very fair, to Clary for this episode because she is grieving. Every action that she does in this episode is a product of grief. And just recently, I know what it's like to grieve. Before now, I wouldn't have known what it would be like to lose someone because I hadn't done so until a while ago. So I understand how desperate grief can make you feel, and it wasn't even like someone really, it wasn't even like my mother that I lost, it was it was my grandfather. So I can't imagine what it's like to lose a parent. I'm going to say that now. So everything that I say about Clary in this episode, I don't completely blame her for, because I don't know what it's like to lose a parent. So I don't know what it would do to a person. That wee sketch at the start was for satirical purposes. It still rings true, but it was for satirical purposes. And I'm not taking a dig at Clary for this episode, because she was grieving very, very badly. So with that in mind, please don't kill me for what I say. Clary has a habit of persisting to do what she's told not to do. She asks advice from Shadowhunters and then ignores it completely. She gets information from Magnus and ignores it completely. She doesn't have a capacity to understand when she is told something that she doesn't want to hear. So she just tries to conclude to herself that they don't know any better and that she is right, and she goes off and does what she wants to do. It's become a recurring theme, it seems, with these seasons for her to do that. In this episode, it reaches the point where she almost takes advantage of Alec's guilt to get him on her side. And I'm saying that very lightly because I'm not blaming Clary. Alec had a hand in this too. I'm not going to treat him like a blameless little demigod who can't do anything wrong. I know he was partly to blame, but it was almost as if Clary took advantage of how he was feeling to get him on her side. Because she was very curt with him at the start when he first came in to apologise, and then she realised, he can help me. And you could practically see that happening as they interacted when he first came back to the Institute. So that was kind of, it bothered me. But as I said, she's grieving, so I'm not going to blame her. I can't imagine what it's like to lose a parent, and I'm not going to pretend that I do. I was devastated when I lost my grandfather, and that's not like a parent. You know, it's a hard thing to cope with, and if you are given the means, if there is a possibility that you have the means of raising them from the dead, then I think anyone would take it. So none of us can play like, you know, oh, I would do better, I would just leave it, because we don't know how we'd react unless we were put into her situation. An episode where I mess about Clary? What? Yeah, I know, but I'm still not a fan of her character, but I'm not going to be unfair just because she did some questionable things in this episode. But we must remember they were questionable things that were a product of extreme grief. So there's that, and I think it could be well understood why she did what she did. Something else that we find out in this episode is that Clary is starting to see runes. This is the theme that was in the book. Clary is able to see runes that don't exist in the Grey Book, the book that has all the runes in it. I think it was in the movie yes, it was in the movie, because Isabel looked at her hand and says, that's not in the Grey Book. So Clary has a I don't want to go into too much detail because I don't want to ruin anything in case the show tries to take it in a different direction. But the way I see it is that they're going this way from Clary can see runes and she's able to invent them and draw them, and then they do special powers that do things that other Shadowhunters can't do. And that's why Jace was so shocked when she was able to shoot like sun rays. I don't know why it was sun rays, it seemed a bit stupid, but she was able to shoot sun rays from her hands. So, because he had never seen a rune like that before, he's never learnt a rune that is able to do that. Clary sees these runes in her mind, she doesn't know where they come from, and then she's able to invent them. So I can't wait to see where they go with that and where that plot will take her, because it'll be interesting to see what they have in store for Clary in relation to that. Alec felt guilty as fuck in this episode, and it was very upsetting to watch. It was clear that he blamed himself for what happened at the Institute, because, well, he did. It was what he said. He said he let the demon in, even though he didn't. If we want to get extremely technical, it was Isabel who was Isabel and Lydia were wheeling the body into the Institute, but even it's not their fault either. It's nobody's fault that this demon got into the Institute, and it's no one who got possessed's fault that they got possessed. It just happened. The demon just was an asshole and possessed them and killed people. But Alec isn't the sort of person to be able to recognise that. He always piles the blame on himself so that he can save other people the burden and the pain of it. So he's this sort of... he was sitting stewing in it for ages. And then there was this conversation he had with Magnus, which you can see my thoughts on in my first thoughts episode. And because of this, when he returns to the Institute, his judgment gets a bit clouded and he decides that he's going to help Clary bring her mum back. With very questionable means. He becomes very protective of her due to the shame that he feels that he killed her mother. And it's understandable, it's not like he was just going to be like, oh, well, I killed her mother, but it wasn't my fault, I was possessed. It was very, like, realistic that he did blame himself for killing Jocelyn, because I feel like anyone would. It's not right, but I feel like anyone would blame themselves if they knew that their body was used to kill a person. And instead of Alec being, like, an asshole towards Clary like he usually is, he actually couldn't face her. He felt guilty. He doesn't have a heart of steel. He does feel emotions like this, even towards someone that he doesn't like. He felt awful that he killed her mother, so much so that he becomes extremely protective of her. He was in there with the warlock woman, I can't remember her name, and was very like, let me see your warlock mark, let me know you're legit, I can't let you near her unless I know. And it was very nice. It was more of the Clary and Alec bro TP. And yeah, I'd like to see more of it, not of Alec being guilty, but of him helping Clary, because it's nice to see. I was watching over my old Fair and Unbiased episodes last night because I'm a masochist and I like to look at how shitty my quality was, and still is, but I've been able to speak clearer now. And I realised that I actually predicted something that I didn't realise. Well, I say I predicted it. I mentioned that Alec didn't use a healing rune because he was torturing himself. I said that people were saying that he was doing that, but I didn't think that he was.
The only problem I would say I have is Alec's injury. The Forsaken injury thing didn't seem to go anywhere. Although there's this common consensus that maybe he didn't want to apply I'm not going to say it because I can't pronounce it, a healing rune, because he wanted to punish himself. Although I'm kind of like, I understand that Alec is very hard on himself, but I don't think he's a masochist. But maybe could have been, we don't know. Maybe it will play in the final three episodes, we don't know yet.
And now it's kind of been confirmed in this episode that he did, that he does use this. He doesn't use healing runes because he likes to distract himself from the pain inside by having a pain outside. And it's a very interesting way for Alec to behave. And Isabel seems to do the exact same thing as we've seen with her demon wound, which is very interesting. You know, great minds think alike, siblings hurting themselves. Alec's interaction with Madzie was lovely as well. The little girl who was the warlock woman's niece, was it? I can't remember, her goddaughter. That was lovely, and it was just lovely to see Alec with the child. It was like, aww, so sweet. And even better, he didn't judge her on her warlock mark. Her warlock mark was the gills that he saw. Every warlock has a warlock mark. It's almost a sign of their demonic blood. Magnus has his cat eyes. Madzie has the gills. If you remember, there was that guy in episode 4, he had the horns on his head. Ragnar's was his big horns. And in the books, he was green. Everyone has their warlock mark. And the fact that Alec didn't judge Madzie or sort of recoil at her for her warlock mark was great, because it's most definitely foreshadowing. It has to be, because there is a point where Magnus is going to have to show Alec his warlock mark. And now that we know that Alec doesn't care, it's going to definitely be a fluffy Malak scene, and I can't wait for it. I think it's going to be great. Yes, Malak for the win. Acting in this episode was phenomenal. I never usually talk about the actors, and I know that I should, because I love every single one of them. They're all amazing at portraying their characters. I'm just blown away with how much emotion they put into their performances. You can tell that they are so into the story and into the characters that they portray that they're almost like lost in the lore, and it's so good. I don't know how else to like translate this. Every single one of them are amazing. The girl who played Madzie was a bit questionable, but come on, she was like 5. We can't like judge her for that. She did amazing for her age, you know. You can't judge a little girl on like on her acting, especially one so young. I think she did amazing for what for considering her age. Crazy psycho warlock surrogate mum, what was that? Oh my god, that was so like out of the blue. I was sitting thinking, okay, well, she's gonna raise a demon by accident. Like, this is what they were leading up to, right? Like, Clary's gonna raise a demon instead of her mum. They're gonna be like, oh, I'm gonna have to slay it. No! Warlock woman is a fucking psycho who kidnaps people and, like, gets demons to, like, rape them, but then they get pregnant with warlock babies? I know they said that the series was gonna get dark, but oh my lord! And then you see that demon that comes crawling out of that hole that Clary was gonna get attacked by. That thing is the thing of nightmares. I saw like when the actors did their after the episode chat for Twitter and Shadowhunters TV, they said that they got a real contortionist for the demon. Oh my lord! It really worked. Turned to me, it made me so uncomfortable, and I was sitting watching it, and I felt as if I was Clary, like, oh my god, don't come any closer, please don't come any closer, oh god, I'm having nightmares when I think of the night. I just know it. It was awful. The woman's reasoning, I can't remember her name for the life of me, the warlock woman's reasoning was, oh yeah, warlocks are dying out, we're a dying breed, I need to make more warlocks. And you're just like, this way though? This way? This way? You're crazy! And now she is freaking Madzie, and it's upsetting. It's like, no, you took the little girl. And I bet you she's gonna come back into it, because she was like, you still owe me a favour. And you're like, oh dear. And Clary made a blood oath, so there's that. That's going to be... I'm interested to see where that's going to go. I hope it's not something that just falls flat. I hope they do go come back to it. It doesn't have to be this season. It doesn't even have to be in season 2B. But I do hope that they do revisit it later, so it's not just like an empty threat that doesn't go anywhere. Interestingly enough, in the books, I'm not sure if it's mentioned in the books, but it's mentioned somewhere that Magnus was conceived because his mother was raped by a demon. I wonder if that's what that's going to play into. If this establishment this woman seems to have created, where she kidnaps humans and shadow hunters and lets demons attack them so that they can see warlocks, maybe that's going to play into more about finding out about Magnus's past. I think it would be very interesting if his mother had been one of the people who'd been kidnapped by one of these establishments, because there's no way that that's the only one. I bet there's loads out there. So if they do revisit it, it might be something to do with learning more about Magnus and his past and what happened to him as a child, which I'm all for. Sign me up for all of that shit. I'm so ready. We also got a name drop of the Iron Sisters. The Iron Sisters are set to show up in the next episode, episode 6. It's literally called The Iron Sisters. So they were mentioned in this episode, and it's mentioned that Isabel looks up to them a lot. And I don't remember a lot of the Iron Sisters from the books. All I really remember is that they made the weapons that the Shadowhunters use, like all the weapons in the Institute, and like the whips and the knives and the Seraph blades. But I really want to see where they're going to go with them, because from what I remember, they were just there for like a plot where they had to go and get something, if I recall properly. I honestly can't remember. But I want to see where they're going with it. I want to see what this plot of the next episode is going to be. There's apparently like a water that they have to walk into that like tells if they're pure or not. So I feel like that's going to be trouble for Clary. I don't know why, but I just have a bad feeling that something to do with her being in love with her brother is going to play into that. So it's all left to be seen. Jocelyn is definitely dead. Well then, I don't know whether to feel cheated. I don't feel cheated. I feel like I should feel cheated, but I don't. I honestly don't care that Jocelyn is dead. Even by the book standards, she didn't do a lot. She wasn't really there for a purpose. As soon as she confirmed or denied the incest thing about Clary and Jace being brother and sister, she really didn't do a lot. She was just there sometimes. So I really don't think it was that much of a problem that they killed her off. I am honestly not too bothered. If there was any character that they were going to kill off, Jocelyn makes the most sense, because not only does she not have much bearing on the future plot, but she also has an effect on the characters if she did die. So I definitely think that it wasn't that bad of a decision. People are overreacting, going like, they're hijacking the mortal instruments, they've ruined the whole thing, I feel betrayed, I feel cheated. Just like, calm down, please. It's not that bad. They need to then kill like Isabel or Alec or Jace or someone. Chill, cool the beans, kids. It's not that bad of a thing. And honestly, I feel like Maxim Roy, no offense to her, was the weak link in the acting string in the show. Catherine McNamara has her moments, but to me, Maxim Roy just never felt genuine in the part of Jocelyn. Maybe that's just me, so I'm honestly not that bothered that she's not coming back. Sorry, Maxim, I know it sounds really, really mean, but it's just what I thought. The funeral was awful. And I don't mean that in terms of quality. And quality was great. The funeral was just awful in the fact that it made me cry for Clary. I don't want to cry for Clary. I hate Clary. It really shows what they're capable of in this show, that they made me cry for a character I don't really like that much. So I'll give them hats off to them for that. But Clary was a wreck. And understandably, as I said at the start, it's her mother. It's her only parent, really. I mean, who cares about Valentine? He doesn't count as her dad. Well, I suppose Luke could count as her father, but that still doesn't take away the pain of the grief now. And it was bad enough that Clary was crying, but then Alec was crying as well. I was like, oh my lord, I am going to die. And I felt all the emotions. It was very well done for not caring that much about Clary or Jocelyn, really. It was a very emotional scene for the funeral, and they left in the details that Shadowhunters were white for funerals because they were black on most days, so it's not really much of a difference. So they were white. It's black for hunting through the night, for death and mourning, the colour's white. There's a whole rhyme for it. I can't remember the full rhyme, but yeah, that's it. It's black is hunting through. Black's for hunting through the night, for death and mourning, the colour's white. So, yeah, it was very upsetting. Made me feel miserable afterwards. But, yeah, Jocelyn's definitely gone. And I understand people are going to be bothered by that, but I'm not bothered. Honestly, for me, it was just, okay. Hard on Clary, but okay. So that's it for Fair and Unbiased for this week. I talked about a lot. I had a lot of notes, but I actually got it all talked out in a shorter amount of time than I thought I was going to be able to do, so that's good. I will see you next week for episode 6, The Iron Sisters, where we get to see the badass ladies that are the Iron Sisters, and the Malik date. See you next week, Shadowhunters, Angels, and Downworlders alike. And remember, please stay away from contortionist demons because they really don't have good intentions in their heads. They want to impregnate you with warlock babies.
Hunters believe in the law as absolute. They can never conceive of one of their own going astray. 19 years ago, their lack of vision allowed the circle to almost decimate the entire shadow.